Hello everybody, this is Vince and Hugo from Fractal Universe.
Hello.
And today we are here to teach you how to play A Clockwork Expectation, our newest single. So as you may have seen, we've just launched a guitar riff challenge for this song. Actually, if you play the opening riff, send us a video of it using the hashtag Clockwork Guitar Challenge and upload it to your favorite social media, and we're going to pick the best version of the riff to win a copy of the record. So if you want to participate, feel free. You have all the tools required. There's a backing track, there are some tabs and everything. And today we're even going to look at the song in more details. So hope you will enjoy.
Yeah. So as you can see, you have the tabs here on screen. And we'll try to see every part, every single riff of the song on guitar. And maybe let's get started on that riff.
Yeah.
That opening riff.
Maybe you can just display both guitars at the same time.
Yeah. Let's try this. How do I do that? Do
you know? Affichage.
Multipiste.
Vue multipiste.
Yeah.
And then you select. You can click on the little eyes. You see the little eyes here?
Yeah.
You activate just the tracks we want.
Yeah. That's it.
Something like that. Perfect.
Okay. Thank you, Vince. This is a live tutorial on how to use Guitar Pro, actually.
Yeah.
I'm going to learn a lot of things. Right. Maybe we should play this one at full speed and then try to slow down a bit.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's just get started.
Okay.
So this is a pretty challenging riff right off the start. I would say it's one of the most difficult on the album. I don't know if you agree, but it's extremely hard to get really tight, and it definitely wasn't in this take.
And maybe it wasn't written on a guitar, I don't know. Maybe the harmony, well, my part here, it's quite challenging because it doesn't have right fingerings. Doesn't have any easy fingering. I don't know if you thought about it when writing it.
Not really. I really focused on the sound, unfortunately for you.
Yeah, but that's it. It sounds killer, so that's
the
most important.
First thing I think we should mention about this song is that's in 6-4 in terms of the time signature. And each beat is divided into triplets, so you have that kind of triplet feel, but in 6-4. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and each one. So it's kind of an unusual rhythm for metal songs. It's not used that often. And it makes it quite hard to get in the groove pretty well if you're not used to it.
Yeah, and since guitar is played mainly with up and downs on the right hand, one beat is going to be down and the other up, and it's not really natural sometimes.
Yeah, you really have to find your way with picking through this song.
Yeah.
There are some instances where I would play it alternate picking, some instances where I would just maybe land on the beat with a downstroke again. We're going to check that when we're going to play the song more slowly. Maybe we should do that.
Yeah.
Maybe let's try it really slowly so we can really focus on the articulation.
Yeah.
Of the part.
Okay. Both guitars at like 50%?
Yeah.
Let's try this.
Ooh, that's slow.
Yeah.
We'll be right back. So you can see in this riff there are pretty much that there are many hammer-ons and pull-offs that allow your right hand to relax a little bit in between of this fast strumming stuff.
Yeah, I see.
But it's kind of hard to have them really tight because sometimes it's quite difficult fingerings for these hammer-ons. For example, here, this one is always pretty tricky to get right because you are playing this note right before. So you really have to get that beefy palm mute stuff and then really nail your legato stuff going on in the treble register. So it's kind of a hard balance to find, I would say, on this riff.
Yeah.
To keep everything even, because obviously it's only triplets. You've seen there's no breathing at all in this riff. It's basically straight triplets all the way through. But the little breathings are given by these little legato passages. But yeah, as I said, they are pretty tricky. Especially stuff like that on the low B string. You really have to get everything to ring out nicely, which is not always easy.
I agree.
And yeah, as Hugo told you, on his part, he has a lot of wide changes.
Yeah.
I don't know what to call that.
It goes something like this. Again, some hammer-ons and put-offs with the pinky. Not the easiest. And then we have that thing.
Yeah, with pretty wide stretches. Which, when you do legato, is always difficult when you do that kind of wide stretches. You really have to put in some energy in your hand, keep up some kind of tension, I think, to make everything come out nicely.
That's it, yeah. But yeah, the most important thing, it sounds really good.
Thank you. Actually, we should mention that this is going to be more focused on the guitar technique. We're not going to talk about the theory behind the song, the arrangement and all that kind of stuff, because we're going to do another video more on that topic next week. So today's purely for the guitar players, how to approach that kind of riff. And yeah, I would say it's really important that you get this triplet feel, that you get a strong sensation of where the beat falls. Because some kind of accents, some of these accents are not easy to get. I'm thinking about this part, for example. If you have the beats in mind, it becomes a lot easier to know where you are. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's not easy to count at the same time, but I think you get the idea. Really try to fit it into your grid of how you would bang your head to that tune.
That's it.
Should we play it again?
Yeah. Half speed again?
Maybe a little bit faster?
Yep.
Something in between?
70%. Let's go. Hands are getting warmer, it's getting easier.
Yeah, one thing also that you have to be careful when playing that particular riff is really the stuff with open strings ringing together. It's really there to add a little bit of tension with these intervals here. So we have to be careful about these notes ringing together. Sorry, I'm lost. Also try to get these low notes here really beefy and stucking out. These are really the main accents, I think, of this part, so pay attention to that. Notes ring together and then mute everything. And have these notes really cut through everything really nicely, I think.
Yep, exactly.
So yeah, there's a challenge running for that riff. It's not easy. I hope some of you guys will maybe participate in that. You just need a 7-string guitar tuned to B standard. And yeah, then you have everything you need, the backing track, the Guitar Pro. And I hope some of you guys will do it.
And by the way, hello to all of our viewers here.
Who's there? I cannot read
it.
There's
Johnny, Claudia, and Shost.
Oh,
welcome
for
here.
Joining.
welcome here. All right, should we move to the next riff?
Yeah.
Where it is.
So the next riff is pretty different. It yeah. opens up the sound really a lot.
That's the verse, actually.
Yeah. Actually, yeah, it's the verse. There are a lot of arpeggios going on. So the focus here is pretty different. Let's play it maybe with the guitar pro at full speed.
Yep.
Just to get everything just on the right page.
Let's go.
Let's give it a try.
The verse riff.
Yeah. Okay, so this one is a lot easier to play from a technical point of view, but there are still a lot of things that you have to pay attention to. First one is to have every note ring with the others. You have to be careful not to stop the other notes from ringing, especially when I do this. When I put in my pinky here, I have to be careful not to mute the open string that is right below. That can be tricky. If I do this, for example, you see, it doesn't sound as resonant as if I manage to keep everything sounding together. It really creates this rich arpeggio here, which is a Lydian arpeggio. So really be careful about that. And there's a little slide here that makes it a little trickier still. So you really have to pay close attention to the position of your pinky. And we try to move my hand a little bit like that, which obviously don't want to do in the long run for long periods of time, but just for some chords you have to do it in order to get everything to ring really nicely, to open up your hand as much as you can. Don't know if you agree.
Yep.
It's kind of a straining position if you hold it for a long time, but yeah, for these arpeggios you have to do that.
Fortunately, I don't have this kind of problem on my part, which is slightly different.
So you're basically playing extensions from the same arpeggio, some kind of inversions with extensions on top of that, which are pretty nice. Go yep. on.
Yep, yep.
So a lot of quartal stuff going on there.
I do have some O chord slides just here. I have to be careful to have all the notes ringing, but muting the strings I don't want as well, which is, it's harder than it looks like, you know. I don't want that string, I don't want that string either, but these ones are sliding, so they have to be really clear.
Yeah, it's the same for my slides here. For example, when I do that, oh, sorry. I want this one, but not the one in the middle. And yeah, one thing I was going to say about these slides is that you will have to be on the right timing when you do these. Because there's a slide up and then there's also a slide down that you want to... We try to go right into the arpeggio when it starts again, like this. So I slide up first. And then I try to end my slide right when I will hit these notes. Otherwise, it would sound a little bit weird if I do. If I come too early or too late, it's going to not sound good. So you really have to find the right timing. This part is not flashy or anything, but still has some kind of things you really have to pay attention to.
Yep.
Basically, it's twice the same arpeggios. A second time the same. And then we move up here to kind of a G. For me, it's a G, G6, a G minor 6 chord. Sliding over to an A minor 7 and then going back down. Same thing, you have to really pay attention to the timing of your slides here. You want to add something?
Yeah, a question about timing. When you do a slide like this, Does the ending note, what is on the beat? Is it the moment you pluck the string, or the moment when you arrive on the, when you land on the note?
Definitely the moment when I pluck the string,
yeah,
because that's where the transient is from your signal. You have the impact from the pick, and basically, yeah, it gives a nice little laid back feeling when you do a slide, because the note, the important note, lands after the beat actually.
Yep. So
this is why I love slides, because it gives that kind of laid back feeling. You have the impact, but the note is not yet there. And yeah, if I would play the slide before the beat, then it would sound really rushed and actually not the way I want it, I think.
Okay.
And then yeah, we have this transition part, which for my part starts out with this kind of Jimi Hendrix chord, it's often called.
Yep.
Like that. And then, yeah, it's basically different dominant chords. The sharp 9 with the flat 9, and then with the open string here. So again, it gets a lot more rhythmical all of a sudden. We had something very open with resonating notes, and when it shifts here, you get something a lot more rhythmical again, with short notes, with triplets again, which we completely had forgotten about in this part. And yeah, it gets denser, it prepares you for the chorus to come.
Yeah. Interesting.
And I think you are playing playing something above my part.
E major, nope.
Yeah, you're playing just an E major.
Yep.
So basically you started out playing higher than I did, and you end up playing lower than I did, yeah.
That's it.
It's a nice way to have the guitars cross each other when you play like that.
Okay.
They switch roles, basically. You played the melodic role before, and now, in the end, I play the melodic role here. I'm playing the more rich part, while you play just a simple E major here. Which, stacked with this, gives a nice little harmony, I think.
I see, yeah. Hello, Sylvia.
Hello.
By the way, in the chat, if you have any question, anything to say, feel free. Hello, Briac. This is a lesson for you. We want to see you play that song. There is a challenge. We just started a challenge where you have to play the opening riff of the song, and the best one wins an album, wins a CD.
All right. Should we move to the chorus part?
Yep. By the way, for all questions about harmony and reanalyzing the song, there will be a different live stream later, maybe next week, if I recall correctly. Yeah. All right, there is a chorus.
Yeah, on the chorus we are doing pretty different parts from each other. Hugo is playing the lead part with a lot of rich chords, and I'm playing something with palm mutes and power chords mostly. So we're going to play the two together, and maybe then we can play each individually, so you get really to hear what each other are doing.
Yep. By the way, I think I should just move this, because I'm on the, my guitar is the lower and Vince's guitar is the highest. All right.
Ah, that's so much better.
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay, let's do the chorus. Should we do it a little slower right off the start?
When OCD kicks in. Yeah, we are like 80%, something like that. Here we go for the chorus. Nope, sorry.
Wrong string. All right, so you see pretty different parts.
Yep.
But we play mostly on the same rhythm, nonetheless.
Yep.
We have different points of focus, I think, in our parts. We don't have to pay attention to the same things. For me, it's really to be in the groove. Have thick palm mutes here. with some open accents here. But in the end, the chords are not very difficult. It's just basically power chords. Some inversions here. And here's the little run we have to pay attention to having every note come out clearly. Which is not always easy because there are open strings in that. So when you have hammer-ons and pull-offs with open strings, you have to use all the tools you can to stop the strings from ringing. So for example, when I'm moving to the B string here, I'm gonna try to mute it, to mute the other strings basically. So that's something you have to keep in mind when you're doing like open string stuff with a lot of distortion. There's gonna be a lot of noise that you wanna cancel out, and that's the case in this lick here. Some stuff like that. See, in the ideal is that you have only one note at a time, so it doesn't get really muddy, especially in these really low register of the guitar, when you have distortion and many notes ringing together, it's just a total mess. But apart from that, yeah, basically just power chords, and you really have to be in that kind of shuffle rhythm. But yeah, that's it. The part develops and goes to the more treble register of the guitar. And you have a little run again here, which is kind of the same idea that I had lower here, but yeah, moved, transposed to a different part of the guitar. But yeah, for my part, it's not that difficult. I chose to give Hugo the worst part because I was supposed to do vocals on that part.
Exactly.
And yeah. And what about your part?
I have that lick that repeats 4 times. What can I say about it? A lot of hammer-ons and pull-offs. And the tricky thing is those two notes on the same...
same fret.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, the same fret. We have to be careful not to ring the two strings at the same time, which is a little bit messy. We have to try to separate them.
I always find that difficult, like playing fourth on the guitar, because the instrument is tuned in fourth, so it's really kind of difficult to play that kind of vocabulary really cleanly. And actually, funny thing is that a lot of saxophone players and all that, piano players, use a lot of fourth in their playing because it's much more convenient on these kinds of instruments, and that makes learning licks from a saxophone player or a piano player, for example, really difficult on the guitar, because you have these things that you have to adapt to the instrument here.
That's right. And the rest of the lick is basically hammer-ons, so nothing difficult here. And then I have some chords, which are, I think, the same chords as Vince, but more rich, with when he plays power chords in palm mute to have a solid bass, I do the rest of the harmony. Yeah. That's it. And I do not have any palm mute ring strings. So I have to make some extra efforts to mute the strings I don't want to hear. To make it clear. And that's pretty much it.
Yeah, I think Hugo in this part is really conveying the whole harmonic information, all the harmonic richness. Yeah. Well, I'm playing the role of the bass player, basically. I'm doubling the bass player with power chords. And yeah, that's what makes it sound really open. More to that next week, I think, in the analysis part of this video.
There is a small, let's say, filler here.
Mm-hmm.
In that case, I don't really bother to separate the strings. I think it sounds right when it rings.
That's the way it's supposed to be.
Yep.
And anyway, you are playing with less gain than I do.
Exactly.
So I have to be really careful about not having notes to ring together, because as I said, I'm in the low register of the guitar, where you don't want to have too much mud going on while you are playing in the treble register with much less gain, which leaves you much more possibilities to have everything ringing together and have these nice, rich jazzy chords.
Yep, exactly.
Jazzy chords.
And we have a question from Johnny. Is that the hardest song on the album?
Oh, no. It's not easy, don't get me wrong, but there are far worse songs. Which would you say is the hardest to play?
The sixth one.
Oh, Withering Snowdrops.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, for me as well, I think. Although there are some songs that are quite difficult, like Black Sails of Melancholia, which is not really really flashy or anything, but still has a lot of things you have to be constantly focused, basically.
For other reasons, it's really difficult, yeah.
But this one is not easy in terms of rhythm. We're going to come to the part that is especially difficult in terms of rhythm. So it's challenging mentally as much as it is challenging physically, I think.
Yep. And thank you, Brirak, by the way, for pre-ordering the album and the vinyl. Thank you very much. So the tricky part.
Oh, yeah. A lot of fun incoming. So let's do that full speed and maybe break it down.
Yep.
And then talk a little bit about it.
Are you playing the arpeggios?
I can, if you want.
Okay. I don't think there are written, actually.
No, I think it's on the guitar below. But
yep, on the crunch one here. Okay, let's start with that part. Ready?
Okay, so what's going on here? I think the metronome really helps. Do you want to do it slowly right away?
Yeah. Like 80, 70?
Yeah. Whatever.
80. Maybe we should try with only the click track. What do you think of it? Just guitars and click track.
If you want. Let's go. Ah, perfect.
What happened here? I love Guitar Pro.
So, it's kind of a mess in terms of the rhythm here. I think some people, when hearing this for the first time, it was the case in the analysis video I did, the reaction video with Cardavox. He was saying to me, yeah, this sounds like odd meter or something. But basically, as you can see, the time signature has not changed the slightest. It's still 6-4. It's basically just the accents being moved around here. And the accents are kind of tricky. Let's not deny it. But actually, to me, what I really have to do when playing a part like that is not forget where the pulse lies. And it's especially tricky because let's listen at the drum part. Maybe if you can from the Guitar Pro without the click, if you can.
You want to hear the drum part?
Yeah, the drum part without the click.
Yep. So it's slower.
You can see there's nothing marking the beats on there. Da, 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 da. There's no element on the drums really giving you where the beat is. So you have to really have to have a strong inner sensation of where the pulse lies. You really have to never forget the ta 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 4 5 6 1 2 3 4 5 6, and the drums is not playing that, so you really have to rely on that yourself. And why I'm saying that is because if you have this strong sense of where the beat is, then it's just triplets. It's just basically some notes are on the beat, some notes are going to be on the last triplet, for example, the second one, 1, 2, 1, 2, and 3. And some notes are going to be on the second triplet. So these are the trickiest to get. 1N, 2N, 3N, 4N, 1N, 2N, 3N, 4N, something like that. So, but if you relate that to where the beat is, it's really just then a matter of remembering where everything lies, and it makes a lot more sense that way. I don't know if I've made myself clear.
For me, yeah. It sounds like Mario Duplantier on guitar. Why? Because it's really maybe percussive. Hello, by the way, Laurent. And no, Johnny, I don't think we are going to show the sax solo today. Maybe we can talk about it when the time comes, but it's mostly guitars today.
Maybe you can play just through this part again, and maybe mute the click. And I want you to to listen to that part and have the tack, 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 tack of the click in mind.
Yep.
Because nothing is going to give it. And that is why when we played with the click earlier, it was kind of ruining the vibe of it, because the click is supposed to be hidden.
Yeah.
And you are supposed to, we as musicians have it internalized, and you as the audience to have this confusing kind of rhythm going on. Let's give it a try without the click.
Full speed?
80%. Yeah, let's keep it at 80%. Yep. So remember, tack, tack, there's going to be the count in. Try to maybe continue to tap where the beats are while listening to that part. 4, 5, 6. Gets easier here because I'm playing on the beat. Okay, I hope you guys did get what I meant here. We try to hear that riff with the pulse in mind. Let's do that full speed.
Yep. Still without the click track.
Yeah. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So yeah, at that speed especially, it's kind of difficult, but you still have to have that that beat in mind and all the subdivisions. So 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4 and a 5 and a 6, if you have that clearly, as clear as possible in your mind, you're not going to get lost in that part.
Yeah, it's still really, I really internalized it, I think. Maybe you should, since I have really close to the microphone, I think you heard me breathing on the beat. Maybe it showed how I think, why I play this riff.
Oh yeah, I totally do that sometimes. Yeah, especially when you have like complicated rhythms with a lot of space, like here. There are a lot of instances where you're not playing on, there are a lot of beats you're not playing on. And yeah, keeping your body into that rhythm or your breath or whatever really helps, I think. And yeah, I think I do that also.
Yep. It gets a little bit more complicated when we have to sing while playing it, but it's cool.
Yeah, because actually the vocals are playing on each individual syllable here.
That's it.
So I remember when I first tracked the pre-productions for this song. In the beginning, I was I had to kind of relearn the pattern, because you don't have the same things you can rely on when you are on your guitar and when you're on your vocals. You cannot breathe while you sing, for example, breathe on the beats like you just said. So you have to relearn it. And especially what's difficult is with vocals, you have some kind of phrases, and for that particular part, the phrases are not necessarily lining up with the cycles. I know the cycles of the music. I don't know if you know what I mean, but sometimes the phrase gets over to the next bar, and then you have to remember not to get confused in the pattern. Although your phrase has ended, the musical phrase has already started again, or whatever. It's even more confusing with an instrument like vocals on parts like that, I think.
And Laurent, I think it reminded him the intro for The Art of Dying from Gojira.
Oh yeah, kind of, yeah. You have this, actually in the Art of Dying, I think the guitar is just playing some quarter notes or 16th notes, but the drums are doing all the job here.
Yeah.
But it's true in the sense that, as you could hear on the drum parts, there's a lot of ghost notes. Basically, the drums are playing all the notes in between what the guitar is doing and is only accenting the notes the guitar is doing. And this kind of ghost notes on the snare really remind me as well of the intro where he's doing like this percussive stuff and some kind of percussion element. I don't remember what it is exactly. I don't know what it is.
Looks like a snare, actually, a rim shot, you know? The rim of the snare.
Yeah.
The rim of
could
the snare.
Could be, yeah.
All right. Should we go to the second verse?
Yeah. We can...
Lot of notes.
Can start on the lick if you want.
Yeah, sure.
It really leads into the next part.
Let's try to play it at full speed. Let's go. Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Sorry.
What's going on?
I think there is one measure and a half. Two, three. Da 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 da. All right.
Okay. All right.
Let's try this again. One, two, three.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is a tricky part as well, and I think in terms of getting vocals and guitar to really line up perfectly, this was the hardest part on the record.
Yeah.
On preparing the live show. I don't know if that's the case for you, but this one is really hard.
Definitely, yeah.
And you've seen in the Guitar Pro, I've actually written where each syllable really lands in comparison to each note. And that's something I really do on these kind of tricky parts. And I used to do it on almost everything when I was first learning how to play and sing at the same time. This is really something I want to encourage you to do. We didn't talk about it, but it's really important, I think. Since I'm a guitar player and singer at the same time, there's really something that I need to work on here. And I hope I can give you some advices if you are going to do the same. But yeah, do what I just did here. And the Guitar Pro, try to write where each syllable lands, because as you can see here, four, the four lands here, I know it, and then it's just a matter of practice. When I know where each syllable lands, then it's just taking it really, really, really slowly, moving forward in little bits. I would, for example, just do the four behind until I'm really comfortable with it. So, four behind, something like that. And in the beginning, I'm redoing what I'm doing here. I'm not trying to hit the notes. I'm just trying to do some rap or whatever. Just have the percussiveness of the voice. So, four behind. You know, something really where I can feel in my body where everything synchronizes and everything. And yeah, that's extremely important to do. Write down, if you have complicated parts like that, write it down as precisely as you can and move forward at very slow tempo and in little, little bits like that. Four behind, and then maybe I add two syllables and until I get everything really comfortable. There are maybe a few, many, many hours of practice spread over different practice sessions, because you need to sleep over this, you need to come back with a fresh mind on the next day and so on, until it really gets natural, because it far from is when you start out. And as I said, yeah, this was one of the most challenging ones on the record, where I really had to dissect everything, which I don't need to do all the time, obviously, but there, I really had to do it.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that.
And I'm sorry you had to do the backing vocals for this.
I think the same I sing the same thing on that part.
Yeah, you're doing the whole verse, basically yeah. harmonized a third up, I think.
And I went to the same process, I think. For behind the mirror, that, and so on.
And what makes it so difficult is that the accents from the riff don't line up with the accents from the vocals. Yep. So sometimes there's an accent from the riff, and the note right after is palm-muted on the guitar again, but accent is sung on the vocals, so it's extremely difficult. You can maybe see it on the sheet. For example, yeah, just the four behind. You can see that the four lands on the palm-mute, and then you have a little legato stuff with no vocals over it, and it's really complicated for this part.
Yeah, and in the top of that, neither vocals or guitar lands on the beat. Actually, the vocals do sometimes.
Oh, the vocals are not that complicated. Yeah. They're basically just doing some kind of shuffle rhythm. Four behind the mirrors, that. It's dark pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Dark and those last sacred remains, or sometimes quarter notes like this. But yeah, it's basically the mixture that makes it so difficult, I think.
And the riff is not easy either.
Yeah, let's talk about the riff.
Those kind of thing that I still mess up sometimes.
In terms of the riff in itself, It looks pretty similar than what's happening in the intro. There's a lot of palm mutes, there's a lot of legato with open notes and accents, a little bit like in the intro, but the feel is really different. In the intro we had something really heavy, really dance and everything, while this part is supposed to be much lighter, actually, and you have to play a lot softer, I think, with less gain also, and that makes it particularly tricky to have every note ring out perfectly with less gain, and you don't have to strum really hard. You have to keep it quite light, I think, for this part.
Yeah.
Because in the end, it's still quite open. It uses the same harmony as the first verse, but yeah, you play every single triplet. Quite challenging.
Yeah, but beautiful. And we have some Lydian lovers in the chat here. I think he's happy.
Yeah, this chord progression, going to talk about that more next week, but it's basically E-flat Lydian going to G Dorian, so some kind of modal mixture here. These two modes are not from the same scale, but it's something that sounds nice to have a first degree switching to Dorian instead of the Aeolian you would expect here. But more to that next week.
Yeah.
Pretty tricky riff, and yeah, an especially difficult part, I think, is the ending run.
Yeah.
Which leads you back to the chorus.
Yep.
So it's difficult because the accents, the notes that are played with the pick are not necessarily on logical accents. I mean, they fall according to how your guitar is tuned, basically. I play these notes with my pick because I have to do that to because my guitar is tuned that way, and when I hear these notes. And that makes it kind of tricky because these accents played with a pick don't necessarily make a lot of musical sense. It's really more like a stream of notes with legato sound, but some notes you have to pick, obviously, but that makes it quite tricky, I think. I don't know if you get what I mean.
Yeah, of course.
It's really the physical nature of the guitar that makes you need to pick these particular notes more than a logical musical phrase.
Yeah. I didn't think the picked note as accent, actually.
Yeah. They shouldn't. They shouldn't be considered accents. But I think in the way you feel your instruments when you play a note with a pick, I kind of conceptualize it as an accent, although it doesn't sound like an accent, but it yeah. still is something where I must put my focus on, and in that sense, it's an accent for my brain. I don't know if that makes any sense, even if it's not a musical accent. I have to deliberately think about playing these notes here.
Yeah. And once again, we have here several notes on the same fret, and these one are really tricky.
How do you do it, actually? I'm curious. yeah. Yeah, that's what I do as well. When I do these kind of runs, usually I alternate between two fingers. If I would, for example, do... Oh, shit. It's a pretty convenient way to get everything separated when playing on two strings. Or like you did in the chorus riff, I think, with pinky and ring finger. You can basically have the same approach here. And it's kind of useful to practice that kind of things because, yeah, the guitar is quite tricky to play with these kind of intervals.
Yeah.
So I definitely recommend practicing all finger combinations like that in order for you to get that correctly.
Yeah, yeah.
Like I just did.
Definitely agree. Yeah.
That's really trickier than it looks.
And that part of the song is really, there's a lot of air. It's kind of smooth. And so we have to make it sound like it's easy.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to sound aggressive or painful.
Yeah,
but
that's...
But is it?
that's the big contrast, as I said, with the intro, yeah. which uses the same tools, basically. Palm mutes, legato, open accents, but yeah, the feel is totally different. You have to make it sound, as you said, really smooth, really open.
Yeah.
While in the opening riff, you really want to dig into the notes. And yeah, that's really sometimes what's trickiest in metal when you play with distortion is to still make it sound smooth, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah, really accent the dynamics when the distortion is actually evening out all the dynamics. You have to make extra effort to bring all these dynamics back in, I think.
Yep. Yeah.
Okay, we're so on the chorus number two.
Yeah, which is exactly the same as the first one, so maybe we should skip it.
Yeah.
And then we just have... Hell, it's time for me to maybe talk about the main arpeggio of the song.
Yeah, I played it once before. On the kind of Gojira part we were talking about earlier. This is kind of the main theme of the song.
I do play it with these two fingers because there is a chord right after, which is it. So it needs to be played with these two fingers to have the whole arpeggio.
So you're using your split
nope.
Pickup on the guitar? No?
No, nope. I don't use it, but for this lesson we only use the rhythmic sound we have. So to make it sound nicer, just for today I use a split sound on my guitar.
Yeah, that's what I did on the record as well. But yeah, most of the time live we try to use the humbucker pickup sometimes,
because
it's sometimes there's no time to switch between the pickups and it creates some ugly transitions.
That's
or split pickups sometimes don't sound that great in live situations also.
Yep.
But yeah, definitely something really crunchy is what you're going for here.
Yeah.
And you want to talk maybe about yeah, paying attention to the to everything ringing together.
Yeah, and the pinky slide, which is a big deal for me. So yeah, you have to make sure your fingers doesn't touch any other string, just not to mute it, especially live when you're alone with your guitar in front of the audience. And then it goes like this. and you just look like an idiot.
Yeah, it just sounds like shit if and everything's not ringing together.
Yeah, and that theme often comes right after or before a huge rhythmic part when we move a lot on stage, and then I have to stabilize and. But sometimes I'm still in the energy of the previous riff, and it just doesn't work the way I want to. Like I'm just ending a really huge riff. I don't know what is the ending riff. And then immediately I have to switch to a really really calmer mood. And sometimes it doesn't work. It depends.
Yeah, and that's something I think is extremely important, that you also practice your songs in fake live situations.
Exactly.
What I do basically is I try to play the songs at home, maybe with the lights off, while standing. I always play while standing when I'm playing Fractal Universe tunes, because that's obviously what I'm going to do live. And yeah, sometimes with the light switch stuff, or even trying absolutely not to look at my guitar, trying to pretend there's an audience in front of me or whatever. And obviously also playing while headbanging and everything. That's extremely important, I think. Maybe bands don't do it enough. Practice on their stage presence all the time when you are practicing a song, because obviously when you're going to play it in front of an audience, you will have to do all of this stuff. So I would definitely recommend that you try out these techniques. Switch the lights off, because on stage sometimes you're not going to be able to see anything.
Yeah.
If there are strobes or anything going on, try to play while standing as much as you can. Try to headbang. Try to maybe play even while not hearing yourself properly. I don't know. Try to find techniques that will bring you out of your comfort zone, because if you are sitting in a chair and everything is fine, yeah, you're going to be able to play the songs, obviously, because you did it in the studio and everything. But yeah, live, it's totally something totally different. Try to bring yourself as much as possible in that kind of situations.
Yeah, because you never know what can happen. There is always something unexpected that could arrive at any moment.
Yeah. And actually, also when we are rehearsing all together, we did it a lot in the beginning. We rehearsed fake technical issues during the rehearsals. Basically, sometimes we would say, would come, hey, you just broke a string. Just pretend your string is broken. You have to switch to the backup guitar, whatever. That's some kind of things you have to be prepared for as well. If you break a string, grab a new guitar, then you have to be able to to play this part off perfectly right right away.
Yeah, we used to do some things like that, yeah. Yeah.
Or, yeah, pretend that Clément has put a hole into his snare skin or something like that. We did that kind of stuff, and I think it really helped to maybe be more ready for that kind of stuff when it happens.
Mm.
Actually, I never broke a string with the band live, but you did on several occasions.
I did.
You have pretty acid fingers, I think.
I don't know, yeah, maybe. I destroy my strings really fast. I don't know why.
Yeah, I think I've broken maybe 5 to 10 strings in my whole guitar playing career. And sometimes I don't change my string for quite some time when I don't have shows or anything. But although I really rarely broke any strings, and it's mostly the low B string.
Okay.
But yeah, so I think, yeah, it's weird how different we are, how different our hands react to basically how our strings react to different hands in terms of how quickly they turn old.
Yeah, that's right. We're not equal in guitar playing.
Yeah,
let's talk a bit about that thing here.
Oh, should we play this part?
Yep, the whole part with drums and everything.
Yeah.
Try to put the maybe that guitar here without click track. Full speed?
Yeah.
Let's go.
Let's do it full speed then.
Yep. Yeah, so on.
So a pretty heavy part. It's really kind of a tribal rhythm, I think.
Yep.
And I think actually this is the rhythm from the intro you have not heard yet. The intro from the full version of the song. So basically it's reusing that exact same rhythmical idea, but totally different. But more to that when you're gonna hear the complete song. Actually, you will hear the intro in Clément's drum playthrough, which a little teaser, spoiler for you guys, is gonna be released next week. So when I'm gonna be doing my analysis video, I will be talking about the intro as well, because you will be able to hear it by then. But yeah, yep. This is the same rhythm from the intro, although you don't know it yet. And basically, in terms of technique, what's going on is we have a lot of palm mutes. In the beginning, it's power chords, and then you have this really dissonant interval here, which is even on the record and also live is played with a whammy effect, which pitches this one octave up to give it an even meaner sound, really something sticking out a lot, really aggressive, especially with the whammy effect on top of that. It's really something, the thing you're going for here, really aggression. Try to hit the strings really hard. Maybe play it a little closer to the bridge as well. We need to have it resonate like that, something really open. And obviously balance that with the heavy palm mutes. And be really careful about this stop here. It's really the heavy contrast between this sudden stop and when it kicks in right away. So you really have to be really clean about stopping your strings here. Did we miss something in the chat?
Yeah. How to not kill yourself is asking if we both play with Floyd Rose. Maybe a word on that right after, when we will talk about the solo section maybe.
Yeah.
And Sylvia loves the sound. Thank you very much.
Cool.
Yep.
Yeah, for this part, what we can add is that here, you have to find right fingerings, because in the beginning it's power chords. And you can see I barely have to move my hand, I just lift it here, so I can get the resonance of the open string, while when I play these palm mutes here, I really try to have my hand mute everything I can here, so I can really hit the strings really hard without being afraid of having some noise. And you see it's just a little movement like this when I play the open chord. I try to not to exaggerate it, obviously. Just to give this string here room to resonate. But apart from that, you can see that I pretty much stay in the same position. That's not the case throughout the riff. After I have to do something like that. So basically, it's quite tricky in terms of fingering. I'm curious about if we have the same fingerings or not. But basically what happens is this note stays, the top note here, but the lower note shifts.
Yep.
To some kind of stuff like that. So you see, in the beginning I'm doing this, because obviously I need my pinky available here for getting the open string. But at some points, with these stretches here, you just can't do them with your ring finger.
Yeah.
So you just have to balance, to find the right switching points between this position, basically, and this position, which enables you much farther stretches. So do we switch on the same time?
No, I don't think so. I do that. You should see on the screen, maybe.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, I tried it that way as well, and I was hesitating, but in the end, I preferred to do the movement here,
yeah.
Because this is kind of easy for me to do while doing... what are you doing with your middle finger, or... Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, this, yeah. Was kind of a hard jump for me to get going from there to there. And I think I evened out the difficulty by doing this, which is pretty acceptable in terms of movement, and then I'm already in place here, and I can do the wide extension while my pinky just stays in the same position. So basically I split this jump to this chord into two, if you know what I mean.
Yep.
This is the idea behind that.
Yep.
But yeah, that's up to anyone to find the right solution. It's just, yeah, something you have to keep in mind. Try out different fingerings and find out what suits you the best.
Yeah.
Because we are all built differently, as we were talking about before. And I don't have particularly big hands. I'm not particularly flexible also. I'm always a little bit stiff. So I have to find my ways around that on the guitar. And yeah, to me, yeah, this move here was much easier than this move here. A lot less tension.
Yeah. And yeah, those stretch chords are a pain. Yeah. Actually, it's not even the worst.
Oh, no.
Our discography.
What's the worst on the album? Do you want to spoil just a chord shape from the record?
I don't know. Something to do with that song. Yeah. Something like that. Yeah,
this chord is pretty high.
Yep. Yeah, on the album I don't know, but there's a lot of them. Oh, maybe this one. Which goes like this. I don't know if you can see. It's not the hardest, but it changes really quickly from one chord to another. And this is really a natural position. But this is it.
Yeah, I think obviously riffs like the opening riff can be extremely challenging because, yeah, you have a lot of movement and everything. But I think like switching very fast from one difficult chord to another is, I think, for me, the hardest thing to do on the guitar, because you don't want to, I don't know if I switch between two difficult chords. Can I find an example right away? I don't know. What could I do? I don't know. That's not that difficult, but you know what I mean? You don't want to have a lot of space in between these chords, so you have to be really, really fast at placing all your fingers and everything, and sometimes that's even more demanding than playing fast runs or whatever. If you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And especially landing extremely fast on chords where there are a lot of closely together ringing intervals, like, I don't know, open strings or whatever, or things like that. You really have to be extremely precise about the movements you are doing. And a lot of time you have to do them fast.
Exactly. I sometimes practice some just fast riffs, some Necrophagist, for example. And it kind of surprises me because I can get to high speed quite easily because it's just that, it's just speed, you know, palm muting one note at a time and palm muting maybe. And I struggle way more when practicing some Fractal Universe riffs because it has chord shapes, it has open strings, and yeah, it's a whole new level in terms of hours practiced.
Yeah, sometimes you cannot really understand how difficult a song is until you actually have to play it. Sometimes something can sound pretty easy, and that's also the point of it. Sometimes, like you said with this part here, we have to make it sound like it's easy, like it's smooth, but there's extremely hard techniques involved behind that.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's the same with chords. Sometimes you just have like two chords that sounds really, really easy. But yeah, to make it sound really the way you want it, it's extremely hard sometimes, even more than all these flashy tapping runs or whatever.
Yeah, that's true, yeah. And Laurent is saying that what we do here, it's like a magician explaining a trick. He can understand it, but he will not be able to replicate it. Well, it's just a matter of practice, I think. But understanding it is already a great thing, you know? you can just practice without understanding it first. Yeah.
And we hope to give you some insights, if there are some musicians here, about how you should practice that. Talking about that, actually, how we practice this song is by really breaking it into small parts, like I explained with the vocals plus guitar stuff. We do that for the instruments as well. We break things down to small parts where you can really focus on all the details. For example, if I want to just practice what I just explained before, the switch from there to there, for example, I try to do it really slowly, try to understand all the movements that are involved. And if I take too big of sequences and take them too fast, I will not be able to focus on everything I need to focus on. So don't overload your brain. Try to really break everything into really small parts. Slow it down so you really know where each note lands. Don't do it by feeling, if you know what I mean, especially for a rhythmically challenging part like that. Try to really slow it down, because slowing down something really will really highlight your imperfections as well, I think. If you're doing something up to speed, maybe you'll be satisfied with something that is like 70% correct or whatever, but if you break it down, you will notice that, yeah, there are a lot of things you're not doing properly. This note lands always a little bit too early. This chord always doesn't ring out nicely or whatever. And yeah, slowing things down and recording yourself, it's really going to help yourself forward, I think. Don't know if you agree.
Yeah, definitely. I should do it more often, I think.
Yeah, I find also that especially when we are playing a song a lot, like on the tour or whatever, each night, because you don't really pay attention to what you're playing anymore, each night the song gets a little worse. Just a slight little bit, but night after night, the songs really get a little bit worse. There are some things you're not paying attention to anymore. Some little details you start doing little mistakes. You start doing the same mistakes over and over again every day, every night. And I think in that cases, really try to break the song down, play it really slowly. For example, I don't know, Onaric Realizations, we played it every night and the opening riff kept getting worse and worse, and just playing it slowly again, refocusing on everything, sets everything right back into place. Your brain gets fresh again on this kind of stuff. And yeah, it's not only important when you are learning a new song, but also with songs you are playing every night and that are challenging. You sometimes have to accept that you have to go back a few steps just to be able to walk, to make more steps forwards afterwards.
Yeah, I think during the tour, maybe every, I don't know, four gigs, I just take my metronome and practice some riffs slowly, just to make sure I still had them right. I don't know if you did that or...
Yeah. Or just maybe when you're on tour, just playing something else also, you know, because we did the same 30-minute set every night.
Yeah.
And basically on some days and many days in a row, the only time we touched the guitar was to play one of these six songs from the tour, and just playing something else also refreshes your brain, reboots it, everything. And exactly. Yeah, it's a mixture of all of that. Never try to always accept that even if things seem like you master them completely, it's never something yet that's totally acquired. You always have to accept to go back, as I said, and retake things slowly.
Yep.
Anyway, I think Johnny asked what our favorite song from the new record is. Can we spoil the title?
For the new album, yeah, for me it's Godless. What's the second word?
Machinist.
Yeah, machinist. Machinist.
Yeah.
Machinist. The last one. I think if you remember Engram of Decline, I do kind of think of it as the collective engram of the album. This is the ending track, long track, and there is so much stuff going on. I love it.
Personally, I cannot choose. I really, it really depends on the mood. Obviously, the ones we picked as the singles, really believe in them. So for me, Clockwork is one of the the favorites, of course, and the two next ones we're going to release as singles as well. I'm not going to name titles, not to spoil you, but there's not a song on the record for now that I'm not satisfied with. I wouldn't say there's any song that I think is a lot weaker than the others or whatever. So yeah, it really depends on my mood.
All right.
There are heavier stuff on the record that I enjoy, or smoother stuff. It really depends. But you will enjoy it, I'm sure of that.
Yeah, you will. So that riff is going on for a lot of measures.
Actually. Oh yeah, we didn't talk about the aggressive dissonance here.
So it's written, it is incorrect here.
Oh yeah, it's the same notes?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, shit.
Shut. Yep, that's it.
We decided to play it here in the end, just because it was kind of easier to get it, especially in a live situation. The open string was kind of tricky to get. But I think on the record, I may have played it like that, just to have the extra gnarliness of the open string. But again, yeah, for live purposes, it's played over here, a little bit darker. Yeah, you can see how the same notes on different parts of the guitar, again, really have a different tone.
Yeah,
and that's
exactly
something I love about the guitar, is that you can do. And all of these are the same notes, but with a slightly different tone. And sometimes, yeah, you can really take that to your advantage, I think. An open string will really resonate differently from a note up here on the fretboard, if you know what I mean.
Exactly, yeah, of course.
So yeah, on the record, it's played like this. Again. Live, we play it like this, because it's easier. I don't know exactly why. Oh yeah, I know why, because your pinky is already on the right string here.
Yeah, just the playing the open string when moving, it's a bit dangerous. We have more chances to pick more strings that we want to. More string than we want to. We have, I think, much more control here than here.
Yeah. And that's something, talking about practicing your songs for live purposes.
Yeah.
That's also something that you should consider. Especially for me as a vocalist and guitar player at the same time. There are some riffs where I try to maybe find fingerings that are in the spot of where my eye can catch the fretboard in a matter of milliseconds. I'm thinking about, for example, the chorus of Fundamental Dividing Principle. There's some stuff, I think, on the record I played up here, but actually moving around the fretboard while I'm not able to look at it, sometimes it's a little bit dangerous, and I choose to play the notes within a same region of the fretboard if I can. Obviously, most of the time you cannot change a fingering that easily, but if it's possible, I try to avoid huge jumps like that if I can. And yeah, that's also something you should consider. I think in a live situation, nobody is gonna notice if I play something here or here. It will sound almost identical. You can make these choices for the record, of course, because on the album you can do whatever you want. You can cheat as much as you want, if you need it, in order to make everything sound great. But for live, you just have to adapt certain things. It doesn't change the song in any way, but it's just a lot more convenient like that. So there's definitely some stuff like that going on. I can't even remember all the little changes I made, because now I'm so used to these live versions of the songs, but there's definitely a lot of that in all our live material. Especially since we are a band that is able to perform all their songs live. We did every single one of our songs live at least a few times. So yeah, you really have to find a way to adapt everything. Especially in a situation where on the record you have a million guitars. You can have a million guitars, a million voices. Live, we are only four, and maybe some samples to enhance that. But yeah, you have to adapt certain stuff.
Yep.
It's definitely always keep in mind. that you can make little changes for live shows.
Definitely.
Something different, studio and live to me.
Some arrangements, yeah, definitely. And thank you very much, Ludo, for your cheers. And thank you for your compliment. Yeah, the video in the cave. Yeah, big deal. We definitely enjoyed making it. Thank you very much. So currently we are explaining how to play the song, actually. And I think we're done with that riff. Do you have something more to add?
No, do you?
Nope.
I will have in the analysis video maybe, but for now I think it's pretty much it. Really focus on the palm mutes, on getting the open strings to sound really gnarly and everything. Try to find the right fingerings for the stretches. Try to find something that doesn't hurt yourself. Try to think about the little stops, the little silences. Try to take it slowly to understand the rhythm. Try to get these notes to really sound aggressive as well. And that's it. It's a tricky part, actually. I think it's one of the ones that is trickier than it may sound to play perfectly.
Throughout all the riff, there is still this arpeggio going on. And I used to play it on stage while Vince was playing the heavy riff. But we finally decided to play the riff on both guitars for it to sound much, much powerful. Still one little arrangement we made, even after playing it several times on stage.
Yeah. Sometimes it just sounds better if you have the two guitars playing that low chugging riff. And in that case, actually, since because we don't really like sampling guitars or whatever, we try to avoid that as much as possible, to try to play everything we can live and leave as much, especially guitars, out of the samples. But in that case, I think it flows really nicely, because Hugo played the arpeggio right before. Yep. And so when it lands then in the samples, it's almost as if it was done using a looping pedal or whatever. And there are other cases on the album like that, where you play a part, and then when you're done playing it, you move to another part, but the part keeps now enters the samples, so you don't... it's almost like you're losing a looper. And I love that, and I'm fine with that. Because
there is there is really few things that we don't actually play in the sample. You see, what you hear... Then what you'll hear in the samples is something we've already played live, so I don't know, it feels better, I think.
Yeah, it feels really natural, I think.
Yeah, more natural, yeah.
Because, I hate it when you have a lot of guitars in the samples, and it sounds like extremely enhanced. I'm fine with having, synths or keyboards or whatever in the samples, because we don't have a keyboard player, and there are always buried in the mix, but always try to do as much as possible live. I think bands like Opeth are really purists in that in that way, and I think it's amazing.
But they have a keyboard player.
Yeah, they do.
All right, and then we have just two measures of the sample.
Actually, what you see on the screen here is that for live purposes we have to make that part longer to give me time to grab the saxophone. But you will see, it really sounds natural that way. We have time to build up the tension. So this section is actually much longer live. Yeah. You can see it on the screen. Maybe it lasts for 8 bars instead of 2.
Yep.
Just to give me time to make the little switches. And then I kick in with the saxophone. Yeah. Unfortunately,
they had to play it on guitar.
No, actually, that's kind of that's one of these solos that really is easy. Kind of easy to play on the saxophone, because it really uses vocabulary that is made for the saxophone and that is absolutely not suited for the guitar, I think. Do you want to try it? I'm not a good sight reader.
And it's
it's in B flat, I think.
It's written like one third down because of the because the saxophone when you play a C, well, it plays an E-flat or something like that.
Yeah, it's a transposing.
So there is a B here, but you will hear a D actually.
Yeah.
Maybe another time I will learn it. I don't know, just for fun, but not here. During the sax solo, this is the intro riff. Well, it is the opening riff. So nothing new here. And right after the sax solo, right after the last note, begins my solo here that I've written here.
And I think somebody asked about the whammy bar.
Yeah.
That's going to be the time to speak about it. Just to get me out of the way, I would love to have to use the whammy bar on my guitar, but I locked the bridge for now because it's more stable. And I think I would need to change maybe the Floyd Rose, because when I'm unlocking the whammy bar, my guitar doesn't stay in tune really well when I'm playing with the whammy bar. So I think maybe I need to change my Floyd Rose, because it's quite of an old guitar. And yeah, I would definitely love to do something, but for now, the bridge is fixed. Up to you now.
Maybe you want to... I think the chords under the guitar solo are the same as the verse. Yeah. So this is E-flat Lydian, right?
Yeah.
With that augmented fourth, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's the Simpson mode.
Yeah, exactly. And it goes to G, to G Dorian, right? Something
correct.
Like that.
Yeah. Can you play the two chords? I'm going to play the Lydian chord.
What do you...
play maybe the E-flat Lydian scale when I'm doing the chord. And then G Dorian. So there's only one note of difference between these two scales, if I'm not mistaken.
Is the flat E that goes natural, and I think I kind of play with that on the solo.
You definitely do.
Let's get to it. Yeah.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
Very subtle.
The most part of the solo was actually improvised, I think. Well, I tried some stuff, and I was like, oh, that one sounds pretty cool, and then I build it around it. And yeah, and the first phrase has a lot of whammy bar. I don't know, I like the vibe of that part, really smooth, you know, and I love those kind of sounds.
Very steep vibe.
Yeah, exactly. With lots of, I don't know, glissando. I don't know what term to use here. You know, when it goes from one note to another without hearing the frets, but one smooth line here, that's what I liked. Maybe I just let me tweak a little bit my sound here. Much better. Oops. Something like that. And yeah, actually I hold the whammy bar during all the first phrase, and for some notes it kind of vibrates, but it's not really, you know, just sometimes it goes a little upper, a little bit lower. It has an unstable vibe to it, and I don't know, I love the sound. And as you can see, I don't pick any note here.
So I guess you have to be extra careful about avoiding resonance. How yeah, do you do that for that particular solo?
You have to have a well-setted up Floyd Rose, which I don't have at the moment. I don't know why that thing won't stay in place. Well, just try to mute the strings with your index finger here while playing.
Yeah, the index has an extremely important role and stuff like that.
Yep.
It's basically the keeper of resonance, I like to call it that way. Especially because when you're playing your whammy bar like that, you cannot use your palm
exactly
to mute the strings, which I really often do.
Yep.
And then you have to rely only on your left hand. I guess it must be quite tricky, especially with a lot of gain.
Yeah, exactly. But actually, this solo don't have that much gain. I think I like to keep all the dynamics of my playing during that specific solo. And the first phrase is just the scale played up and down, nothing more. But maybe I give more importance to some notes. Here we have that note, which is the characteristic note of the Lydian scale, I think. Yeah.
Exactly.
So really, really, really expressive note here, which resolve here on the major third. Well, not exactly.
You're only playing on the column notes here. You have the the ninth.
Yeah. And then on some notes to give it some spice. No, I just hit a bit the whammy bar. No, it's more like a little bend. But it's even faster than a bend. And I like it. And for the last one, I do the... It don't have any official name. Some guitarists call it the ruler effect. You know, when you have a plastic ruler back in school, you press it on the table and then... You tap it, you hit it, and it does that sound. And that's basically what happens with the whammy bar here. But yeah, today my guitar is quite annoying. Something like that. It goes and it's cool. And that's it. And then I finish the scale here. Three notes per string. Pretty easy, actually. And then a little phrase which will, I don't know, announce the next chord. Yeah, and it lands on the natural E, which is the characteristic note of the G Lydian scale.
G Dorian, you mean?
The Dorian, sorry, yeah.
And yeah, it's a characteristic note, and it's also
the one that's different from the previous scale.
How do you call that? The kind of find the word? Not modulant, the modulating note?
Maybe. It's kind of, yeah.
Alteration note?
Well, the note that is different from the previous scale, basically. And then again, I just finish the scale. And then we have that phrase. almost everything on the same string here.
That rhythm looks really complicated. How did you conceptualize it? Probably not at all. Right?
Yeah. Exactly. I didn't.
That's important to tell, I think.
I had one note for the beginning, one note on the ending. But actually, what I had in mind here was kind of anticipating the E major chord that went right, I think, on that measure. Yeah. What you hear here with those taps notes, here you have an E, here a G sharp, and then one B here, which is the E major chord. And I don't know, I thought the... I don't know, the there is a whole note scale here. Well, some kinds, actually. Some bits of the whole note. Those note here, what we have here? I don't actually know. E, B flat, C, D, and E. And
so you have the whole tone scale.
Yeah.
And yeah, I think what you did is just to anticipate the dominant.
That is the E major, which is the dominant chord of the chorus. With then resolve to here, A minor.
So it's something you can you do a lot, especially in jazz soloing. You can anticipate the chord before it comes in your solo, or you can delay it. For example, if I do a phrase like I want to resolve it. Sorry, what did I do? Yeah, if I want to resolve my phrase to a C major, I can do. Can delay the resolution as well. That's kind of the opposite, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You anticipated the following chord, you can also delay it. Yeah. You don't have to perfect on beat one of the new chord, start the new color. You can anticipate it.
That's
very
it.
Very naturally, like you did it there.
And I think that's what I did here. And rhythmically, I don't know, I just played some notes and tried to fit them in a given number of beats.
Actually, I think what's here? How I hear it is you have the accents
ta exactly, yeah,
some kind of shuffle accents that you add in the vocals for behind the me. It's some kind of the same stuff ta, and then in between, I guess it's just
yeah, but it doesn't land on the
not exactly.
It's not a real shuffle, since I think this note doesn't land on the last triplet of the beat, but right in the middle, I think.
Okay.
Ta di ta di ta. So it's not really in the vibe of the rhythm behind it, but it's so fast that we don't really actually hear it.
I think when you have rhythms like that, you really have to focus on these accent notes.
Exactly.
You have to focus on these. You want to put them in the exact spot, and then you can see the rhythm when it's written down is absolutely horrible. If you wanted to play that without these accents, it would be almost impossible. Although I think some...
I think those accents, yeah, is something to catch, to get the thing. Dun, dun, dun. And it gives a little bit of meaning to it.
Yeah, that's something you can only do. I think it's much harder to do when you are alternate picking or something. It's really something suited for legato, where you can just let your fingers flow really well.
I think it's this kind of. You often do this kind of things on saxophone, right?
I think so, yeah, because there's no really transients or whatever on saxophone.
Just blowing some air and play the notes, but there is not, you know, there's not a rhythmic end, I think, to have some logic, to apply some logic to it.
So yeah, I think many saxophone players think like that. They have some runs, some very fast runs, and a lot of then it's just about thinking where the accents are going to lie, and obviously what notes you are going to do in these runs. But yeah, the accents are extremely important. Which notes are on top of the run, for example here, your tapping notes, these will stick out particularly. And I think one guitar player that does that kind of stuff extremely well is Alan Holdsworth. With his absolutely purely legato technique, he does a lot of these runs where there's no clear rhythm. It doesn't mean he has bad rhythm. Absolutely not. He can play absolutely in sync. He can play on every subdivision he wants, but he also has this more free legato runs that are just based on more of extremely fast flow of notes and accents that you really have to focus on.
Yep. And just to end the solo, here we have a the dominant scale. I don't know how to...
Phrygian dominant.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Which is... yeah, which is the scale of the dominant chord, actually. And then three diminished chord, I think. Which is still on the dominant arpeggio, I think.
Yeah, it's fitting the scale.
Yeah. And then we have those two notes, which are B and E, which are part of the dominant chord. And then it became E and C. Something like that. Which is part of the A minor chord.
Oh, amazing. Yeah. So you resolve this note here, which is basically a leading tone. Yeah.
Yeah.
Leading tone resolving up.
That's it. The B goes to the C. Maybe you should try to, I don't know, play the solo, but just with two guitars. I don't know what you think.
I was just going to say something about the contrast between your two runs. You have the legato run that we just discussed.
Yeah.
With the very open rhythm, focusing on the accent. And it heavily contrasts with your alternate picking run right after.
Yeah,
which puts everything back into something more rigid in terms of rhythm. And that perfectly well fits with what the guitars are doing with the, which is also the rhythm guitars, and basically the whole section is also losing this open, very very atmospheric vibe and going back into something more structured.
Yeah,
this is exactly what you are doing in the solo. I think
it goes from something quite smooth to that, which isn't really
and even the alternate
anymore,
run.
Yeah.
So yeah, let's do it with two guitars.
Yeah,
two guitars if you want.
So I begin on the fourth beat. Yeah.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Something like that.
Oh, we suck.
Yeah, it's recorded. It's too late.
Anything going on in the chat?
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
Sylvia is telling that she wish she could play it. Well, that's what those kind of lessons are for. Good luck with that. No, thank you very much for your compliment. And then we go to the chorus.
Chorus number 3, which actually is a slightly a little bit different from the other choruses.
Exactly.
But maybe we go more in detail about that in the analysis, theory analysis part, because there's some modulation not happening here. But apart from that, we discussed it already. And maybe you can jump right to the next part, which is the, some call it the Iron Maiden twin guitar stuff.
Yeah.
Where you need like a really glowing hair, whatever, like a fan in front of you and that kind of stuff.
Yep.
Well, that's basically what you need to play this part right.
Let's play it, I think.
Yeah, if I can remember it. Let's try this.
Yeah.
decay. And then it's the end. Destruction. Destruction is next. Should we play it a little slower? Just maybe to focus on the on how the two guitars are intertwining.
Yeah.
How they are interacting.
Yeah, it's slower. No, I think I just... Let's put the click track
in
the bass.
Please, yeah. The RSE sound is really horrible.
Yeah, it's not the worst, actually. I choose a drum sound that's not the worst.
But yeah, there are no ghost notes. They are totally inaudible.
Yeah,
so.
And the cymbals go...
Yeah.
It's kind of annoying. Let's go.
Okay, so for the most part we are playing in unison, in rhythmical unison, I don't find the word for that, but not all the time. Sometimes there's a little bit of question and answer going on, especially in the end where we're not playing exactly the same rhythm, but for the most part of it, that's it here. So what you want to focus on here is really the expression. It's really extremely important that you put as much emotion into your playing as you can, so there are a lot of things to consider. You have to reconsider your bands. What I like to do with bands most of the time is really rake into them, so not just do, which sounds a little dull, but really, so what I do is really scrape all the strings I'm not playing to really give it an extremely powerful vibe. So it's done on nearly all the bends here, especially the long ones. I don't know if you rake as well on these bends.
Yeah.
Yeah. Most of the time I don't even realize I'm doing that. It's just part of my playing style. We have these extremely aggressive bends, and then also the vibrato, which is extremely wide on the bend. I almost bend all the way up and down, so if I do it slowly, it sounds absolutely horrible, but these really wide vibrato gives it a lot of expression, I think. So that's really something you should consider. Rake into your bends and try to do that kind of aggressive vibrato.
Yep. Hello, Cyril. Thank you to be here. And thank you very, very much for your subscription.
Subscription.
7 months. Thank you very much. And yeah, we really concentrated, really focus right now. It's not that easy. All right.
I can't read the chat from where I'm standing. I need glasses.
Yeah. Nibartini saying hello.
And hello, Nibartini.
And saying that we are really focused. Focused. And he subscribed. Thank you very much.
There's also a lot of slides going on, a lot of legato. Basically, all the assortment of techniques you can use as a guitar player are present in there. Legato, a lot of slides, as we discussed too. To really make it singing, you really have to consider your guitar almost like a voice. With your voice, you can do all kinds you have all kinds of ways to express yourself. And the guitar, I think, especially with distortion and delay, really mimics the expressivity of the voice really well, and that's what we try to do here. There are some tricky parts here where you play the same note, first fretted and then with a bend like that, which you have to be really careful about being in tune, and then it heads right to the next bend. You see what I do here is I hold the note up and this note is already bent. So that's something that is not easy, really, to get these bends to sound really in tune and juicy, especially when they are leading into each other. For example, like here, as I just said, you have this one and then you don't bend down, but you change the note and then finally you bend down and back up. These are all kind of techniques that really make me really love the guitar, because that's some things you cannot do on many instruments. We have these kind of expressivity with the bends and everything. Don't you, if you agree?
Yeah, I do.
And that's why
I think an electric guitarist has a really lot of tools to give his phrase some expression, some expressivity. He has a big palette of different techniques and textures to make one note sing, I think.
Yeah, because if you think about it, to play this note, well, let's take the root. For example, I can play like that, I can add vibrato to it, I can bend into it, I can bend down into it, I can slide into it, yeah, I can slide down into it, I can hammer it on, I can tap it, whatever. There are so many ways to make the same note.
Yeah, I think you give it a little pinch harmonic. You did it, I think, without even realizing.
Yeah, that's sometimes with the rake, yeah, especially when you, and that's something that we really try to focus on also in the solos or in the leads. The way you hit the string will make certain harmonics maybe come out more. For example, if I play a note like this, it sounds really different than when I really dig into the note. You can see there's almost a harmonic wanting to come through. I can make it come through entirely, but I can really play with that, with the harmonic content that is present in my note. And yeah, that's that. These are tools that are extremely hard to master, but still, when you manage to play a little bit with that, it gives you a huge palette of colors for the same note.
Yeah, exactly. And I think you will learn more about the melodic and harmonic content here maybe next week for the analyzing live stream.
Yeah.
But yeah, really interesting stuff. It's you talk about the Iron Maiden part.
I've heard someone call it like that. That's why I'm saying that.
Yeah. I get the point. I think it was Christian Andreu from Gojira, actually.
Oh, yeah. Correct.
But I don't think there is any phrase in Iron Maiden's discography that are as interesting as this, because it's not only just played on thirds, you know, it has a lot of stuff going on.
A lot of chromatic notes.
Yeah, and yeah, some duality between one guitar with the other. It's not always the same technique that are used as well. It's really interesting, I think. Sometimes it has sometimes a note changes for one guitar, don't for one other guitar.
Yeah, a lot of counterpoint.
Yeah. Here we have a thing like that. I don't know how we call it. On the second guitar we have that. We have a bend. And here we have just really, really small details like this. I think it makes the thing shine. Well, that's my advice on it. All right. And then we have the crushing outro here.
Yeah. Let's play it. Let's try to make it right.
Yeah. Are you making a big scrap?
When I'm coming from the lead part, yeah, I don't remember how to.
All right.
Oh, so you can maybe add that as well.
Yeah,
that's how it is on the record. The record, the rhythm guitar is doing some kind of transition. Some kind of weird transition like that with harmonics, and then a pick scratch.
Oh, that's cool. I'm learning some new things here.
Yeah, you know.
Yeah.
That's why we do this, so that we we at least can learn our own songs.
Yeah.
Great.
Great. Magnificent. Let's try it. Full speed. With drums, bass. And yeah. Let's go.
Let's go. Thank you, Mr. Guitar Pro Drummer. That was amazing.
I don't know why he does something like this.
Yeah, it's because of the ghost notes and stuff. He doesn't like ghost notes, I think, the guy.
Indeed.
Mr. Inside the Computer. So yeah, what's going on here? Did you guys recognize this rhythm? Basically, it's the same rhythmical idea that we had on the bridge part. It's exactly the same rhythm, but now we're playing it. We're playing all the notes long, but it's exactly the same rhythm. So what you want to focus here in terms of just the technique is we have juicy palm mutes. What I'm doing here is a power chord with a flat 9. Extremely nasty sounding chord, extremely evil sounding chord. And when you palm mute it, it really gives that unrestful vibe to it. It's not stable as a power chord, it has this extremely evil kind of vibe you're looking for. And you really want to have these palm mutes as aggressive as possible to really have sustain, so you try to dig into the notes. And what's quite difficult is to have each palm mute to sound, to have all your palm mutes sound very even. You don't want to have something like that when your sound changes with every note. What makes it really heavy is that you are constantly hitting the same spot, getting the same sound out of your guitar. And yeah, you really have to be extremely stable in terms of your right hand position here to really get the resonance, the same amount of resonance, the same amount of attack with each palm mute, I think. Otherwise, it just doesn't work. And again, there is this this open arpeggio that we had on the riff already. It's basically the same stuff going on, so I'm moving from this position with my hand, really trying to mute as many strings as possible, to this position where I'm opening up the stuff just a slight little bit. Wrong riff. No, absolutely not. Yeah, whatever. We're gonna play that again. And can we do it again? And I want you guys in the chat to try to do the same thing that we did before. Maybe you can slow it down. And I want you to again, because let's listen to the drums maybe.
Yep.
Again, just the drums, even if they sound like shit. You will get my point. Because again, there is nothing giving the pulsation. There is no ta 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 ta. So again, you could confuse this with some odd time signature stuff going on. There is no odd time signature. It's still 6-4, but we have completely lost the ta 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 pulse, which can make it sound quite confusing. Let's try to play it again slowly. And I want you guys to try and tap along the pulse, the ta 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 ta, because again, this is what you need in order to perform this riff properly.
But just one moment. Guitar Pro is doing things again.
Yeah, it's the worst software ever, but at the same time, the best. It would be nothing without this.
Well,
but it has caused me so much pain as well.
I was thinking exactly the same thing. I love Guitar Pro. I use it for maybe 15 years, I don't know. And it basically taught me how to play electric guitar. I use it every day. But this is the 7th version, and it still feels like it's not finished. I don't know.
It still has a horrible amount of bugs, of... of crashing and everything.
Yeah. So, but yeah, I think it's better than nothing.
And I lost so many tabs because of this shit when we worked on the. But I tabbed out songs, new song ideas, and sometimes the file would crash and never reopen again. I would have to retab everything, or sometimes I could save little bits of it, whatever. It's just horrible.
Imagine a whole Fractal Universe album like forgotten in the limbs of Guitar Pro. Let's try it.
Keep the pulse in mind. Ta, ta.
Ta, 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 ta.
sorry. It's not easy to count. And
no.
Should we do it again at full speed?
Yeah.
And again, keep in mind, try to count along.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Did you guys manage to do that? It's maybe a bit hard at full speed. But if you guys want to have some fun, maybe slow down the YouTube video 75% or something and try to keep the pulse.
Yeah.
I think it's not that easy. But it...
Yep.
And I think that's it for the song. We've reached the end. There's just the...
Yeah, just one last arpeggio here. I push down the Floyd, the tremolo bar, and that's it. And we've seen the whole song, I think.
Yeah.
If you guys have any question, anything to ask or to say, just feel free.
And yeah, quick reminder that we just launched a guitar contest for the opening riff that we discussed in the beginning.
Yeah.
Basically, there's a backing track there, the tabs for the opening riff on our Facebook and all the social medias. There's a link for that, along with a video of me playing it. And yeah, what you guys have to do is just try to play that riff, and maybe you guys will win a signed copy of a new record. So yeah, let us know if you guys want to participate. Just send us a video with the hashtag Clockwork Guitar Challenge, and yeah, that's it.
And yeah, Cyril, I don't know if Guitar Pro is made in France, but anyway, thank you very, very much for your donation here. Oh. I think you've just reached the goal. Thank you very much. Oh. I think you reached like all the goals we've set it up since the beginning. I don't know. But thank you very much.
That means we have to release the video for Tears of Misanthropy.
Yeah, that's it. Thank you very much. Oh yeah, it's Arobaz Music. It's from Lille in France. I didn't know that.
What are you talking? What do you...
Guitar Pro.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. So Laurent is saying that it's done in Lille, France.
Okay.
That's good to know. Anyway, guys, I think this whole lesson will be released soon. Maybe we will cut up a bit. Yeah, but we recorded everything, so you'll find it on YouTube some days after, if you want to rewatch some things. And then I think it's time for us to say goodbye to you.
Yeah, thank you guys for watching. Definitely stay tuned for the analysis video, where I'm going to dig into the composition. We talked a little bit about it, but a little bit more in depth about the scales, the modes, the compositional techniques, all that is used in the song, how every idea is reused in different ways throughout the song. And also we're going to dig into the arrangement, and especially on the production side of things, with all the different layers, with the synths, with the acoustic guitars that are on some part of the song. Yeah, going to have a look at that.
And yeah, proud of our ingénieur informaticien. Yes, we are. And if you have any question, just write any comments. Write the comments on any social media. We try to respond to almost everyone. So feel free to ask us.
Yeah, and if you guys have some suggestions about what you guys want to see, we did like a reaction stream. Last Wednesday, I know many of you were there, where we talked about the making of the video and everything. If you guys have other ideas, other things you would like us to know, like a Q&A, whatever, If you want like a drum analysis from the same song, whatever, just let us know your ideas. Let us know in however way you like. Write to us on social media, whatever. We're always open for new ideas. So yeah, let us know.
Yep. All right, guys. I think it's enough for today. And see you next time, I hope.
All right. Bye, guys.
Cheers. Thank you again, everyone, for being here tonight.